Hello, I am Dr. WAFAEY, BADAWY. I'll be talking about thyroid nodules, cytologic clinical correlation, part 1. This lecture is for pathologists and surgeons. General background about thyroid nodules. Thyroid nodules are very prevalent. They are found in approximately 8% of adults by palpation, 41% by means of ultrasound, and in 50% in autopsy pathological examination. The prevalence of solitary thyroid nodules in children is relatively low, 0.22 to 1.35%, compared with adults 4%. The thyroid nodules are either benign 90% or malignant 10%. The frequency of malignancy in nodules of pediatric patients is much higher than in those of adults, estimated at 15 to 25% compared with an adult rate of 4%. Benign follicular nodules. Generally, most thyroid nodules are benign, as I mentioned earlier, 90%, and comprise a morphologically diverse group and can be classified as adenomas, that is follicular and oncocytic adenomas, colloid nodules, congenital abnormalities, cysts, infectious nodules, lymphocytic thyroid, Hashimoto's thyroiditis. 10 to 15% of these cases are associated with nodularity, granulomatous nodules, hyperplastic nodules. Malignant thyroid nodules. Thyroid carcinoma represents approximately 1% of all new cancers reported in the United States, about 12,000 per year, and 92% of all endocrine gland cancers. Despite the low number of clinically evident cases, incidence of occult thyroid carcinoma has been reported in the range of 4.2 to 10% of all autopsy specimens. Well-differentiated thyroid cancer, that is papillary, follicular, and Hertz cell thyroid cancers, it accounts for 95% of the thyroid malignancies, and 5% of these patients will have familial disease. Classification of thyroid cancers. It depends on the type of cells. Follicular cells or parafollicular cells. It would be follicular cells can give rise to differentiated or anaplastic undifferentiated carcinomas. The well-differentiated carcinomas include follicular, Hertel, papillary. Parafollicular cells can give to medullary carcinoma, which can be sporadic in 80% or hereditary in 20%. Risk factors of thyroid malignancy. Risk factors include pre-existing benign thyroid disease, residence in endemic goiter areas, prior radiation exposure, it is a dose dependent, autoimmune thyroiditis, Hashimoto's thyroiditis, family history of thyroid malignancy, certain inherited syndromes such as Cowden syndrome, irregular menstruation, bilateral oophorectomy. Primary thyroid malignancies are divided into P papillary thyroid carcinomas accounting for 80%, follicular thyroid carcinomas 5%, medullary thyroid carcinomas 5 to 10%, Hodgkin cell oncocytic carcinoma 2 to 3%. It is considered as a variant of follicular carcinoma. Anaplastic thyroid carcinomas 1 to 2%. Primary thyroid sarcomas rare. Primary thyroid lymphomas is also rare. Diagnostic imaging, ultrasonography, radionuclide imaging, other imaging techniques including CT scanning and MRI. Ultrasonography is a safe and effective method of determining the size and the presence of solid or cystic components and abnormal features that, for example, calcifications and vascularity within a thyroid nodule. High-resolution ultrasonography can be used to determine the presence of non-palpable nodules as small as 1 millimeter within the thyroid tissue. Ultrasound-guided fine needle aspiration cytology is becoming popular. Use of thyroid ultrasonography does not allow accurate prediction of the histology of solitary thyroid nodules. It is very important. What are the sonographic features favoring a benign nodule? It includes uniform halo around nodule, predominantly cystic within incipitated colloid, completely avascular, a large thyroid with multiple nodules, hyperechoic solid, perinodular appearance of vessels in around 25% of the circumference. What are the sonographic features favoring a malignant nodule? Hypoechoic solid nodule, presence of microcalcifications mainly associated with the papillary thyroid carcinoma. Coarse calcifications can be seen in both benign and malignant nodules, for example, medullary carcinoma. Peripheral rim calcification is mostly common in multinodular goiter, break in which indicates a malignant change in underlying multinodular goiter. Local invasion of surrounding structures favoring anaplastic thyroid carcinoma and thyroid lymphoma. Taller than wide in transverse plane. Suspicious neck lymph nodes suggesting metastatic disease, such as lymphadenopathy with microcalcifications. Intranodular blood flow, hypervascularity by color Doppler, irregular margins or ill-defined margin. This photo shows a non-homogeneous hypoechoic solid papillary thyroid carcinoma. See the white arrow with poorly defined margins and irregular lobulated contours. Here we can see ill-defined margins. More than 50% of its border is not clearly demarcated. Here we can see microcalcifications. See the white arrows, upper image, pinpoint punctate areas of increased echogenicity measuring less than 1 millimeter. This is the definition of microcalcification, less than 1 millimeter. Macrocalcification, white head arrow, upper image, areas of increased echogenicity measuring larger than 1 millimeter. Here we can see coarse calcifications. It occurs in medullary carcinoma, may coexist with microcalcifications in papillary cancers. Peripheral rim calcification, most common in multinodular goiter. Break in peripheral calcification indicates malignant change in an underlying multinodular goiter. Here we can see taller than wide in transverse plane. In these two photos, we can see marked intrinsic hypervascularity, intranodular hypervascularity by color Doppler. Flow in the central part of the tumor is more than surrounding thyroid parenchyma. These features, the previous features, are more useful in selecting a nodule for FNAC in multinodular goiter. Here we can see transverse grayscale sonogram of a metastatic lymph node from papillary carcinoma of the thyroid. See the arrows with echogenic punctate calcification, the arrow heads. Power Doppler sonogram showing around hypoechoic malignant lymph node. Now the presence of peripheral vascularity, see the arrows, the white arrows, is common in malignant nodes. Radionuclide imaging, it is called also functional imaging. Radionuclide imaging using radioactive iodine and technetium, that is technetium thyroid scintigraphy, has been the mainstay in the evaluation of the thyroid solitary thyroid nodule. Thyroid nodules are further classified into cold, warm, and hot according to their ability to accumulate the radioactive isotope. Please note that the hot nodules are very rarely malignant. Cold nodules are considered hypofunctional, whereas warm nodules are normal and hot nodules are hyperfunctional. The major limitation of thyroid radionuclide scanning has been its inability to distinguish between benign and malignant thyroid nodules with high accuracy. Other imaging techniques. CT scanning and MRI have a limited role in the initial evaluation of the thyroid nodules. Indications for these imaging techniques include suspected tracheal involvement either by invasion or compression, extension into the mediastinum, recurrent disease. Classification of thyroid fine needle aspiration cytology into Bethesda categories. Every patient with a palpable thyroid nodule is a candidate for FNA. A very fine 25 or 27 gauge needle is ideal for most thyroid nodules because the thyroid gland is very vascular. Fine needle aspiration of the thyroid is the diagnostic tool of choice because it is a rapid and cost-effective test. It is a very useful method in classifying thyroid nodules as either benign nodules, so reducing unnecessary surgery, or suspicious and malignant nodules in approximately 3% to 7%, so requiring surgery. Please note that again, thyroid FNAC is a screening test, a diagnostic tool for the initial evaluation of thyroid nodules, a triage for further investigations. Bethesda system for reporting thyroid cytopathology. The Bethesda system for reporting thyroid cytopathology facilitates communication among cytopathologists, endocrinologists, surgeons, radiologists, cytologic, histologic, correlation for thyroid diseases and other health care providers. The BSITSA system classifies thyroid FNAC into 6 categories. It is very important to know that each category is linked to a malignancy risk and has a recommended clinical management. What do you see in the pathology report? Recommended diagnostic categories. Category 1, non-diagnostic or unsatisfactory. Including cyst fluid only, CFO, virtually a cellular inadequate cellularity specimen, other such as obscuring blood clotting artifact, category 2 benign. It accounts for 60% to 70% of the thyroid FNAS, consistent with a benign follicular nodule, including adenomatoid nodule, colloid nodule, lymphocytic Hashimoto thyroiditis in the proper clinical context, granulomatous subacute thyroiditis, other. Category 3, a tibia of undetermined significance, follicular lesion of undetermined significance. It is a major part of the indeterminate category. Category 4, follicular neoplasm or suspicious for a follicular neoplasm. Specify if Hodgkin cell oncocytic type. Category 5, suspicious for malignancy. Suspicious for papillary carcinoma, medullary carcinoma, metastatic carcinoma, lymphoma, and other. Category 6, it is malignant, including papillary thyroid carcinoma, poorly differentiated carcinoma, medullary thyroid carcinoma, undifferentiated anaplastic carcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, carcinoma with mixed features specify, metastatic carcinoma, non-Hodgkin lymphoma, and other. What are the thyroid nodules with indeterminate cytology? These are the nodules which need further investigations and procedures, such as a lobectomy for definitive final diagnosis. Indeterminate cytology results can be seen in anywhere from 3 to 18% of biopsies. Indeterminate cytology includes a tibia of undetermined significance, BSITSA category 3, suspicious for follicular or Hodgkin cell neoplasm, BSITSA category 4, suspicious for malignancy, BSITSA category 5. These are the references. We wait for the part 2 for more details and specific scenarios. Thank you.